What you're seeing here is a genetic algorithm in action, attempting to get better at the game Stair Dismount, in which the goal is to knock the character down a flight of stairs and get as much damage to their whole body as possible. So the first generation of this algorithm is just going to try a bunch of random candidates. And so a candidate is just one set of settings, you know, a force, heading, pitch, and selected body part. And that's what you select in this game. You select the force, heading, pitch, and the body part, then you click dismount, your character gets launched down the stairs. To actually choose the force, you have to wait for it to come around to the force you want, because it actually just keeps bouncing back and forth until it reaches a certain value. And so the way I'm doing this is with a Python script. This script here is actually controlling this executable. It actually launched and is controlling that executable. And the way it's doing that is by reading and writing to various memory addresses. So these memory addresses I had to find through trial and error using the program Cheat Engine. But you could do that with any sort of memory hacking software. You would just need the ability to scan for addresses, you know, look for changes, and also browsing memory nearby other values was very useful in this case. So what the script does is it launches the game, it waits half a second for the game to actually load up and for the window to open. Then what it does is it checks that the foreground window is indeed the game. And so here's where it does that check right here. If the process ID value is not equal to the main class process ID, which I generate in the process interface class, which I just grabbed some of this code off Stack Overflow and changed a couple things. You know, this is just pretty standard code for accessing a process in Windows. And so in order to make sure I had read and write access to the memory, I stuck in all these options here. I don't know if these are all necessary, but it works, so I just wasn't going to change it. So all this code is just pretty simple stuff for starting up the process using the ctypes library in Python. It's just starts it up, gets the handle and process ID, and then also you can read and write memory. And so what I'm doing here is I'm starting that process. I'm checking if the foreground window is indeed that process, and I'm getting the foreground window so I can get the window handle. And I need that window handle so that I can compare it to the foreground window, because I get the window handle if I just grab the foreground window. So it's an easy way to compare that foreground window handle to the one I grabbed earlier. So what I can do, or what I do now, is I have it press space. And so the thing is, I cannot actually send keys to this when it is in the background. It has to be in the foreground. I haven't figured out a way to cause the game to properly reset the character and then launch him off after the... just poking with memory. I have to actually press a key or fake a key press, in which case I'm doing that with Pi Auto GUI. So now what I'm doing, what I do is I write out some memory actually to just mute the game's music and sound, and that's just preference. You know, I could disable these and have the sound music be going. And so then what it does is it generates a number of random candidates. And so I've chosen 16 to be the number of candidates here. And so what happens when it creates a candidate is that it sets the pitch, heading, force, and body part to a random value. And the body part will be a value between 0 and 13, because there are 13 different body parts, and those all correspond to different indexes in this list here. These are just offsets to a certain memory address. This is just how the game works. I had to figure these out manually, but... you know, that work is done, and it should work if you run this on other systems as well. It's not just specific to my computer or anything, you know. So force error here, that's when it's waiting for the force to reach a certain value. It's within 0.05. The force is between 0 and 1, so it's going to be within 5% of the value. But what I'm actually doing is, before I actually dismount the character, launch him down the stairs, I'm actually just setting the force anyway, just to hopefully make sure that it's the value I want it to be. And in fact, it seems that it does work because every time it runs the exact same the exact same set of settings, you get the exact same score. These look like the same settings, but the pitch is different, so the score is totally different there. But these two here, these have the exact same settings, the exact same force, heading, pitch, and body part, and so the score was identical. And that's really good because we have consistency here, meaning that if I run the same thing over and over, there will be no difference in score, no randomness. So that's really handy for this genetic algorithm, which is just a blind algorithm. It knows nothing about the game. All it does is it sends inputs and it grabs the score at the end, and then it uses a roulette wheel selection, which is kind of a random selection of candidates, but with a higher probability if the score was higher. It uses that to select a couple of candidates and then breed them together for the next generation. And actually, we can see here how this is happening. So I'm just going forever. There's no exit conditions unless I close the process, in which case I'll get some errors and it'll just kind of more cleanly close out because I've set up some code below to handle that. So what I do is for each generation, I loop through all the candidates, and what I'm doing now is I'm actually preparing these values from the candidate to send to the game. And so they're displayed, forces displayed as this bar here. The heading is and pitch are displayed in degrees. Body part is just indicated on a UI. So the selected body part actually is you have to set a memory address, the value of that memory address to a different address, that address being a pointer to a body part. And so that's what those offsets were for, because I can just grab this base body part body part's base pointer here, add those offsets to it, and then get the final value. And so for the pitch and heading, I have to take a value in radians. So I'm actually generating the value in radians and sending it in radians. The only time I'm converting it to degrees is to display it. But otherwise, this game actually internally works with it in radians. And the force value is actually between 0 and 1, so I'm just multiplying it by 100 so that I can see that as a percentage. I'm rounding it here for display purposes. Here's where I'm setting the body part. Here's where I'm setting the heading and pitch. And then for the force, what I have to do is I just have to keep checking it. So here's where I'm grabbing the double value from memory. And I'm checking if that difference is less than that error. So right now the error is 5%. So if it's within 5%, it's going to write out that force anyway, just to hopefully have it be the value I want. And it seems like that always works, so I might not need to actually be checking for it constantly. Actually, I'm not checking constantly. If I was checking constantly and not putting this sleep here, it would hammer the CPU, and that would be, unnecessary. So what it does is it actually checks a certain address in the game. And so that address by default is some value. But once he reaches the bottom of the stairs and just nothing else is happening, it changes to either 3 or 4, depending on what the high score is. And then in that case, I break out of the loop and I read that score value and I add 1 to it just in case it ends up as 0, because I don't want to divide by 0 later, because I'm kind of doing some, I do some division with the scores. So what I do now, I'm appending that score to a list of scores so I can do some statistical operations on it just for display purposes later. And then what I'm also doing is seeing if that candidate score is higher than the highest score that has been seen before. And if so, I set the high score to that. So with it, what I then do is I press enter and space to completely reset the game back to a state in which I can try out the next candidate. And so once all those candidates are done, it sorts them by their score from highest to lowest with this reverse equals true here. Then what it does is it creates a probability distribution that will all sum up to 1, but the numbers are all proportional to their score, relative to each other. And so something with a much higher score is going to be much more likely to be selected in this random choice function here, which for each, while the new candidates list is, the length of it is less than my length that I set up here. So It grabs two candidates from the current generation. So the first one it grabs here, the second one, depending on whether or not I'm checking to see if the mate it grabs is actually like a clone, the exact same, has the same genes, depending on whether or not I'm checking that, I either just grab one and don't care if it's the same one, or I check to make sure that the genes are not equal. And so my crossover chance is 1.0, so this will always be true. But what that means is if I want to combine the candidate and the mate, God, that's just what I call them here, if I want to combine their genes together. And so what I do is I find some point in the middle, and so it's like the force might be from one, but the heading, pitch, and body part are from another. Or maybe the force and heading are from one, the pitch and body part are from it, So what I do then is I add those to the new generation. And I also then, once I go through that new generation, or before I add those, rather, I mutate each of their genes. And so right now I have it set the 1 in 1,000 chance for any of these genes, force, heading, pitch, or body part, to select a completely new random value. So then I append that to the new list of new candidates. If the score sum to 0, which this isn't really used because I'm adding 1 to every, score, but it would make an entirely new generation because like that one was terrible. But this isn't really going to happen with Stair Dismount. If I were playing this to some other problem, there's a good chance that the whole first generation might have scores of all 0. So now here's the statistical information. I'm getting the average and the median of the scores, which you can see here. And if I start looking through this list, we can see the first generation's average score was 38,000, and it's typically around 30,000. The median was actually 41,000. That's pretty good. High score of 100,000, that's really good. First generation to have a high score of 100,000 is pretty decent. The highest score I've ever seen is like 160,000, and actually that was generated as like the second candidate on the first generation, so it was a completely random candidate. So it kind of like showed that this algorithm isn't always going to be entirely useful. Anyway, so we can see the next generation, the scores definitely look higher, and if we look at the average at the bottom, we can see that it is 64,000. It's almost doubled. The median score is 56,000. That how did that change? Yeah, so it's increased as well, but the high score has not changed. So the current generation is going right now. We can see that the candidates are have pretty high scores, but we've only seen three of them so far. So essentially, the longer you let this run, the higher the scores will get. But if you don't really have enough candidates, like right now I only have 16. So what's going to happen is probably they're all going to end up being almost the exact same candidate. So you'll want to have probably larger generation sizes. And of course, with a game like this, which takes a few seconds for them to fall down the stairs each time, it's going to take a long time if you set your generation size to like, 100. But that would be, the more the better. I've gotten pretty good results from having a size of like 20, but like I said, more candidates means more diversity and more things, more combinations and all that. So all it does is it shuffles up the candidates once it's done doing the breeding. I don't know if that's really necessary. I just wanted to do that. And so if there's any sort of error, such as if I close the game, it's gonna write out, see, it prints out the top score, and the top score is this right here. 11 is a body part, and this is the heading, pitch, and force, or something like that. And these are in the actual values that the game uses. So it's in radians, and the forces between oh yeah, 50.08%. I think that's pro wait, no, which one would that be? It would be the, yeah, 50.08%. So it's this one right here. This is right shin number 11, and then these are the I think that's the pitch and that's the heading. And so I can actually just copy this and just paste it straight in to, if I wanted my first candidate to have like a really good score, what I could do is say candidates, the first candidate, will have these genes. So I need to actually do this here. And so supposedly this should get a score of exactly 100,057.71 if I run this again. So the very first candidate should get that exact score. And sure enough, the score is exactly what I thought it would be. So that pretty much covers the whole thing. Feel free to, I'm going to provide a link to this, so feel free to play around with it. And there are definitely plenty of other games that you might be able to apply this to. The reason I chose this one is just because you set up a list of values, just a couple settings, and then you just try it and see what the score is, and you get an objective score. It's not like a subjective game in any way. So you just put in the values, you get an output, and you know, that's kind of an ideal thing for an easy, like, blind, dumb genetic algorithm. And the score will increase over time. It usually gets to maybe 120,000 to 150,000 after several minutes of running, and that's pretty good. Those are, like, not quite competitive high scores, I guess. I mean, the high score board has long ago stopped working in this game, so I can't really check, but, you know, pretty good scores. The highest I ever saw, again, was 160,000, and that was just from a completely randomly generated candidate. It didn't actually breed other candidates to come up with that one, so that was a stroke of luck. But it definitely increases the average score and the median score over time, and it comes up with some pretty interesting ones. Typically, the most common thing it'll do is either launch the hand or a foot, and cause the guy to whip around, hit his head a few times on the stairs, you know, doing a lot of damage to the head. But it's really fun to just kind of let this go in the background and come back to it later, and then see what kind of bizarre things it's come up with. And I've done other things too, like make it not reverse the list of scores, so it comes up with only I don't remember exactly how I did that, but essentially I made it select for the lowest score, and so it was pretty hilarious watching him just sit down and take almost no damage whatsoever. So, like I said, hope this was informative. I hope this script is fun for you guys to play around with. The only thing that you would have to do to personalize this to make it work on your system is simply change this path here to where you actually install the game. And then you should just be able to run it, assuming that you have these libraries, which should be, you know, very easy to get if you know how to use Python. And then you're good to go. You can use this to kind of see how a genetic algorithm works. And usually you would do it with more values than just four, but like, you know, four is all this game actually takes, and it seems to work pretty well with this, so it's a really fun thing to play around with. So hope you guys have fun. Thanks for watching, and I hope I'll see you next time.